July 15th, 2021. From El Cajon, California, this is episode 237 of You Can Bet on That. Hi, everybody. Welcome to You Can Bet on That, a podcast for the recreational gambler. My name is Mark Duvall, and sitting across from me is Dr. Mike.
Hello.
So on our last episode, we were comparing Las Vegas to Atlantic City, and we pretty much said there's nothing else to do in Atlantic City other than gamble.
Well, for us, that's true.
So it's not exactly what we said, but that was kind of the gist of it, was that, you know, there's so many things to do in Las Vegas, and, you know, Atlantic City definitely is more about gambling, you know,
right.
You know, like we were saying, you know, day trips. After we were talking about that, we thought, well, I wonder what people will actually have to say about it. And sure enough, our buddy Ed O'Connor sent us a big list of things that you can do in Atlantic City that are not gambling related. And
right.
I said, Ed, is it okay if we post this list to our page? Because he had a big, you know, list of everything. And I thought, you know, we could go over it on the show, but it might be a kind of a nice resource for people to, you know, take a look at and think, okay, what else can I do in Atlantic City? So that's exactly what we did. If you are on a computer and you go to our webpage, youcanbetonthat.com, you'll see a link on the right side of the page that says Atlantic City Non-Gambling Attractions. And just click on that. Yeah. On mobile devices, it's a little trickier. We don't pay a lot for our website. It's basically just to host the podcast. And on a mobile site, you may have to do a search for like non-gambling activities, but it'll come up that way. You know, things like go to the Steel Pier and go to the aquarium, you know, and there,
right.
He put together a nice list. So thanks for that. Again, Ed O'Connor for sending us that list. We got an email from listener Drew. He says, coming from a poker background, I understand position relative to the button, for example, under the gun. However, when I hear people talk about position at a craps table, I am totally lost. Do you think you could explain position to your listeners, please? Well, positions at a craps table are not quite as formal as a poker table. Mainly because you can have a lot of people at the table, you know, crammed in. And in some cases, you know,
right.
Maybe you've got
eight,
you know, 10
people. Well, back in the old days before COVID... Pre-COVID, we should come up with the term.
Pre-COVID, that'll do.
That'll do?
Yeah.
I mean, no, there should be something funner.
Oh, okay. Well, pre-pandemic, that's not all that fun, I guess, either. Pre-lockdown? I don't know, Mike.
Just,
something
all right,
funner?
Funner, yes.
All right, so,
we live in San... We go to Funner every weekend.
That's right.
So.
That's the name of the town.
But I'll tell you what. Seriously, somebody needs to come up with something that's pre- and post-pandemic. That sounds good.
That's kind of fun.
Yeah, because pre-pandemic and post-pandemic sounds almost medical, you know. It's
well,
like a,
well,
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, I mean, it, you know, we want something that we can use and get a smile out of.
Okay, every time is okay. Right. All right, we'll think about that between now and the next episode.
Because what I was going to say is pre-pandemic.
Yes.
When they let tons of people, I mean, it would be 8 to a side. But some every once in a while, there'd be 10 on a side because, you know, oh, we can cram you in here.
Yeah, if they
we'll
wanted
get you
to
in here, especially
yeah.
if, like, one table was open
mm-hmm.
and people would stand sideways
oh,
so
sure.
that they wouldn't take up as much room.
Sure, I've done it. I think
yeah,
that
oh,
happened
yeah.
at the D when we were there for
yes,
360
yeah,
Vegas Vacation. Remember that,
did.
That big roll? Yeah,
yeah,
I was.
A lot of people wanted to play.
Yeah, I think I actually so, had to step away from the table
yeah,
every
I think,
roll.
Yeah,
I could kind of squeeze in to make my bet,
and
then I'd
back
away. Yeah.
So in those days, position was a little different because yeah. it wasn't standard, you know. Yeah.
Well, let's talk about a few positions that actually do have names.
Not the positions I was thinking. Go on.
First of all, there's stick left or stick right. Those are kind of self-explanatory. If it's stick left, that means you are to the left of the stick person, and stick right, you're to the right of the stick person. We've also got in the hook. That's basically the curve in the table that's on the stick person's side. So not the curve that's kind of towards the pit area, but that initial curve,
yeah.
you know, on the stick person's side. That's called in the hook when you're standing right in that corner. If you're at the very end of the table, that's often referred to as straight out.
Right.
And if you're standing right next to the base dealer, so not the stick person, but the
one, of the,
one of the base dealer, it's just next to base, something like that, you know.
You'll hear that.
Yeah. Now, the dealers might use those terms, or often they'll just say, my second, which would mean the person two over from where I'm standing. So if I'm the stick man and I say, oh, 15 change to my second, that's an indication of the base dealer that he or she needs to give $15 to the person two away from the stick.
Right. And on their side of the table.
Right, on their side of the table. Yeah, or the stick could say, oh, you know, $20 change, you're first.
Right.
Or you're third, talking to the base dealer. And it would be that away.
Which is the person next to them, they're first, or the third would be three people away from them.
Right.
So that's more common.
You do hear that more common. Although, you know, sometimes, again, it kind of works the both either way, too. The base might, you know, say, oh, that hard way, that hard six in, for the hook.
Right.
You know, something like that.
Right.
So
when we get a casino,
yeah,
we're going to have labeled at each position the name of that position.
Okay.
And the dealers and stick person will call the person by their position name.
Okay.
You know.
And are they going to be whimsical, or is it going to be,
well, it'll be something like
Disney characters or something?
This is where the shitty don't player is. It'll just say shitty don't player.
Uh-huh.
And it'll say, okay, pay the shitty don't player $15.
Oh, okay. So you have to make sure if you're in that spot.
You're a shitty don't player.
Yeah, I got that. Well, I sure am looking forward to that casino that we open.
Yeah,
that's going to be fantastic.
It's going to be nice.
Yeah, it will be. And maybe there's some other positions we're forgetting. But again, it's not as formal as, you know, under the gun or in the hijack or on the button, you know, that you hear at the
casino's
poker table.
Going to be in Reykjavik, Iceland.
Really?
Yeah, Reykjavik. I've always wanted to go there. We're going to open a casino there. And it's going to be no limit. You know, every table's no limit.
Really?
Yeah, we're just taking whatever.
So basically, the martingale will work at any of our tables, is what you're saying.
Eventually. Yeah, eventually it will work.
Eventually it will work.
If you have unlimited cash.
Yeah, okay, good. All right. Well, Dr. Mike, on the last episode, you promised to provide suggestions for low-limit players on how they can play at some of these higher-limit tables that we're seeing post-pandemic.
Right.
You know, a lot of the, during, you know, when the pandemic was still going on and the casinos started opening, the table limits jumped quite a bit. They would limit the number of people at the table, and the table limits would jump. And the limits really haven't gone all the way back down yet. They're still pretty high.
Right.
So what are some of your suggestions for a low-limit player at a high-limit craps table?
Okay, here's the first thing I'm going to say. I'm going to preface all my suggestions by saying this.
Okay.
The very first thing you need to do is set some restrictions on yourself.
Okay.
So this may not work for everybody because you have to know your own self, and you may not be able to live with the restrictions.
Okay.
But you do have to have some restrictions if you're going to do this. Mm-hmm. Number one restriction is you have to set a time when you're going to give up or leave.
Okay.
Let's say you say, well, if I double my money, I'm leaving.
Okay, so it might not be...
Or if I lose all my buy-in, I'm leaving.
Right.
Or if I lose half my buy-in, I'm leaving. You just have to have some well-defined definition of when you're going to leave. Because if you say, I'm just going to stay here for 8 hours, well, playing with a limited bankroll at a higher limit table, it's eventually going to eat you up.
Right. So you're not thinking in terms of time necessarily, but an event. Once you've hit this event.
In an event.
Then you walk
unless
away.
Unless your time is like, well, I'm going to play 30 minutes and I'll be happy with that and leave. You know, maybe you can do that.
If it's a short time, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
But you can't say, I'm going to stay here all day and play at this table. It's just, it's not going to happen in craps. I guarantee you.
Right. Eventually you'll lose everything.
Eventually you'll lose
everything. Yeah.
You're going to hit a bad streak.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to be out because, as we know, craps is a game of ups and downs.
Yep.
And honestly, you're really sitting there hoping for the big roll.
The big roll. And a lot of times there's only one big roll in a session or a day.
Or in a day, or maybe none, right?
Yeah,
there's plenty. We've been there plenty
sure,
of times.
Sure.
But you're hoping for that big roll, so you're wanting enough of a bankroll that you can wait it out.
Yeah, right.
So you can wade through the bad rolls.
This is a very general statement about craps that would apply to anybody.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
To anybody, no matter what. But if you're on a limited bankroll, it's even more important because you have this limited bankroll.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing I want to say is that you probably should define an amount of money that you think you can live with. Now, if you're playing on a $25 table and you think, well, I'm a low roller, I'm going to buy in with $100.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's no way to play on that table with $100.
Okay.
Or something. It's just, I mean, you put $50 out there, you make two bets and it's seven out,
mm-hmm.
your money half gone, and you know, you could be gone really, really quick.
Right.
So I think that really to play at a $25 table, you're going to need between $300 and $500 buy-in.
Okay. So even if you're a low roller,
right,
think in terms of buying in for that amount with the, and you're going to have some more suggestions here, but I wouldn't expect to lose all of it. 300 within 10 minutes, right? Okay.
Right. And maybe you say, okay, I'm going to buy in for 500.
Mm-hmm.
That's my cushion for the day. I'm okay with losing 500. That's number one. You have to be okay with losing that.
Absolutely.
And then second of all, you could say to yourself, okay, I'm going to buy in for 500, but if I'm here, you know, an hour from now and I have only 300 left, I might be okay to go.
Good.
I might be good with a $200 loss or a $300 loss.
Yeah.
Or if I double my money, or if I get my 500 to 750, then I'm out of here.
Sure, good, okay.
So if you set limits for yourself like that, that's going to help a lot.
Now, I know there are a lot of people out there who feel that if you buy in for 500, you should be willing to lose 500.
Right.
While there are some who psychologically like the idea of, I'm going to buy in for 500, but if I lose 200, I'm leaving.
Right.
And I understand that psychology, right? I understand the idea of that cushion. It's like, okay, right, I'm walking away with chips.
Right. Well, it makes you feel like it wasn't a disaster.
Right.
And buying in for 500, but setting your limit like, okay, if I lose 300, I'm going to quit.
Yeah.
Because if you start with a small amount, psychologically, you lose one bet and you're like, oh my God, I lost a quarter of my money.
Yeah. This is, I think, going to come down to personality.
Exactly.
And again, we there are different opinions on this. So,
right,
you know, we're not going to say one way is better than another, but you know, what's your personality?
And like I said, at the very beginning, you have to know yourself.
Yeah.
You have to know your personality. I mean, some people won't set a limit. They'll buy in for 300 and they'll lose it quick and they'll just go to the machine and get another 200, you know, and buy that. And so if that's your personality, then you have to adjust how you play to suit your personality.
Yep.
So those guidelines being established at the beginning, I think, is important.
Okay, good.
So then when you get up to the table and you go to play, there are quite a few things you can do. I think the easiest thing is to just decide, okay, 6 and 8 come up a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to bet 6 and 8. You don't even make a pass line bet.
Right.
You wait out the come out roll till a point's established, no matter what it is. And then you place the 6 and 8 for $30 each.
Right.
Uh-huh. And you hope that one of them hits. If it was me and I was trying to survive for a long time on my $500, I would put $30, 6 and 8. When one of them hits, I'd collect.
Mm-hmm.
Second one hits, I'd collect.
Mm-hmm.
Third one hits, I'd probably collect that one too, just so I have a winning roll.
Yeah.
And then after that, if something hit, I would either press that one a little bit, maybe go to 36 or something.
It would,
Or maybe get a $25 five, you know, whatever number you like.
Yeah.
And of course, I'm using 6 and 8 as an example, but if you want to be riskier, you could do the 4 and 10 or you could do the 5 and 9. Mm. I think one number is not enough to keep most people interested.
Right. Yes.
But two numbers.
Makes a big difference.
Makes a huge difference. Three makes even more of a difference. Yeah. So that's one way to go about it.
Right. And, you know, as we're moving through this discussion too, let's make it clear that we're coming up with ways that you can play at these tables, but will it satisfy your craps itch? In other words, just betting the 6 and 8, can you just do that?
Right.
And I know some people, I could.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. You know, I have.
I probably
can't. Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just because we know our own nature.
Yeah. Yeah.
For me, it would get boring after a little bit, but some people might not, and they might enjoy playing at a higher limit table, watching some guy who's got a $1,200 six or something.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, they might enjoy that, the excitement of it, you know. A lot of people get excited seeing other people win. My father's one of those people. He's more concerned about everyone else winning than he is his. I used to tell him, Dad, why are you worried about that guy's bet? Well, he's betting so much, I want him to win. Well, Dad, worry about your own bet. I mean, he would play blackjack and worry about other people the way they played their hand.
Yeah.
That was his nature.
Yeah, sure. So I think this is a good suggestion because if, you know, a shooter gets stuck on 6 and 8, you know, you could make a lot of money.
Right.
Now, the downside, and this is certainly possible, is you could go 3, 4, 5 shooters. Nobody rolls a 6 or an 8.
Right.
And, you know, suddenly you really are, your bankroll is at risk. So that is a possibility.
And that is the risk of playing on a higher limit table.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But you are negating some of the risk by not taking every number. Now, what if you said, okay, I'd like to play the pass line? Well, fine, play the pass line. Maybe don't take odds.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Just $25.
Mm-hmm.
How about I play the pass line for $25 and I don't take odds, and then I make a $25 come bet, and I go up to one number. Now I got two. No odds. Maybe I take a third number even, you know, and hope that they repeat and could work out, you do well. It could be an immediate out and you lose your pass line, but you win your combat.
Yep.
So it's a push. Or it could be, you know, the person rolls three numbers, different numbers, and then seven's out. And so you lose $75. So in any of these scenarios, there's going to, I can tell you the good scenario and the bad scenario,
Sure.
But you're not putting a lot of money out there, but you're still got some stake in the game.
Right. And, you know, if people are thinking, well, wait a minute, Dr. Mike, you're telling us not to take odds?
Yeah.
Yes, we are, because of the bankroll.
It's,
you know,
the
we're talking
roll,
about
right.
low limits here.
Now, plus, if you have a big enough bankroll, then by all means, take odds.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And the thing is, you know, those sevens and 11s on that first roll, I'll tell you, I can't tell you how many times we'll be there. And that's all I'm doing is, you know, pass line and come bets. And, you know, I'm on the pass line and the first roll's a seven and the second roll's an 11. It's like, wow, I'm up $50.
Right. Or, you know, plenty of times it's seven and 11, then, you know, another seven, you've got $75 and you'll turn to me and say, well, there's my odds, yeah, right? I just made my odds if the point's 4 or 10.
And even though we do recommend taking odds because it's a great way to play, keep in mind that in the long run, odds don't matter.
Right.
They really don't. There's no, you don't have an edge on them either. They don't have an edge on you. Sure, that's what makes it kind of a good bet.
Right.
But you don't have an edge
either.
You
don't have an edge on them either. Yep. Yeah. So that's another way to play. I would suggest staying away from all the prop bets.
Good. Yes.
Because they're high risk. Sure, they're high reward too if they hit, but they're really high risk.
Yeah.
So
let me interject here. A lot of times at these higher limit tables, there's also a higher limit on those prop bets.
Right.
A lot of times at
$25 prop bet.
But it will depend on the casino.
Right.
So, you know, check. If it turns out that you're at a $25 table and they will let you just bet a dollar on a hard way, well, shoot, throwing $1 on a hard six every once in a while, that's fine, right? You know, if you just want that excitement.
That's the point or something.
Right.
Yeah. Or $4 even.
Yeah, for all of them. Yeah.
There are things that I see people do that don't make sense, that are low rollers. For instance, a guy came to the table the other night, $50 table, and, you know, he's putting $5 prop bets out there. Well, you know, he's putting $20 on the hard way, and then he throws out a $20 horn.
Yeah.
And, you know, if they hit, great, you just made a bunch of money. But when they don't, you know, you lost $40 out of your $200 you bought in for.
Right. And if that's your plan, like in your example, that's what he kept doing until he ran out of money.
Until he ran out of money.
Yeah.
And you're going to run out of money that way.
Yeah.
In our example of the six and eight, sure, we could go five shooters. Nobody rolls a six or eight, or it's six immediate outs.
Yeah.
But that's one extreme. Mm-hmm. And there's also the extreme where, you know, the first thing you do is bet six and eight, and a guy rolls four sixes and two eights, right? And you're like, you're $200 up, and all of a sudden your $500 bankroll is a $700 bankroll.
Right.
So it can go any of those ways. And you have to, if you know enough about the game, you understand that.
Yeah, right.
There are other things I think you can do as a low roller.
What do you think of this, Dr. Mike? If they will let you do the do we don't, that's where you make a bet on the pass line and on the don't pass. What about, say, making a $30 pass line bet, a $25 don't pass bet?
Yeah.
Now, essentially, what you're doing there is making a $5 pass line bet.
Right.
Now, the worst case scenario, and it's going to happen one every 36 times, is a 12 is rolled. You lose your pass line and your don't pass is a push.
Right.
But for those remainder 35 times, it's as if you're just playing a $5 pass line bet. What do you think of something like that?
Oh, let me ask you this. Are you going to do the same with the come bets? Are you going to make a come bet and a don't come bet?
I mean, that's a good question. I've really never seen anybody do that.
No.
But if you wanted to do it,
right,
it's not too bad a way to go.
No, it's not too bad a way to go. But I'll tell you what. Number one, a lot of casinos will not let you do that.
Well, that's true, too. That's a good point, yeah.
You know, you may try and do that, and they may say, no, do we don't here.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're taking up space.
Sure.
You know, they know they're not going to get much out of you, and you're just taking up space. That's what basically why the casino doesn't like that.
Right, right.
If they do let you do it, if your personality is such that you can do that. Because honestly, that takes a very unique personality.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what. Well, how about this, then? And this was another thing we were going to mention. Let's say you go up with a friend. So both of you are going up to the table together.
Now that I have seen more.
Yeah.
Where one person's playing pass and one person's playing don't. And they're really together, their money's joined.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's say you did that and you've decided, okay, we've pooled our money here.
Right.
Anything we win or lose, you know, we're going to split. Now, we've seen people do that where they're really trying to act like they're not together.
Yes. I saw they don't want a man and a woman do that Harris Rincon a while back.
Yeah.
It was like a mother-son.
Yeah.
And they were trying very hard to pretend like they weren't together.
Yeah.
But to anyone who had their eyes open, it was pretty obvious.
Well,
they're looking at each other. They're giving eye signals.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if you're on a poker table, I mean, that was blatantly obvious what was going on.
Well, how about if you go up and you're just upfront about it?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, yeah, we are doing this together.
Right.
Now, again, will the casino care? It'll depend on the casino. How about this? So forget about the do we don't. But again, let's say you go up with a friend. Again, you decide, okay, this is one bankroll. We're going to split this one way or the other. And, you know, one of you makes a $30 six bet. The other one makes a $30 eight bet.
Okay.
Now it's as if you only have $15 on each one.
Okay.
Right? You know, something like that, where you're kind of limiting your risk, you know, but you're sharing the wealth at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, you know, if your buddy and you both have a bankroll of, say, $400. You know, one makes a 36 and one makes 38. It's like, and you're sharing your money afterwards. It's like you yourself made a $15 six and a $15 eight.
Exactly.
So you've played at a $25 table with making it a $15
table. Yeah, exactly. Right.
And that is certainly good to do. And if you're good enough friends or related,
right,
like husband and wife or something like that, then it'd probably work out great.
Well, you could even add more people, you know, three people.
Right.
Right. Sure. You know, suddenly, you know, six and eight, and then the other guy bets on the pass line.
Right.
Right, you know, and you just, so again.
You get four people and you take all the inside numbers.
There you go, you go.
And maybe, you know, if it's, you know, a $15 table, you could do the same thing.
Same
a lot
thing,
of people
right,
are looking for a $5
right,
table.
Right, right.
Well, if you get a $15 table and there's two of you and you're betting, you know, then maybe you're making like 750 bets.
Right, yeah.
You know, which is not that much more than a $5 table.
Yeah,
so, you know, that might be the smartest thing to do. And have fun. And, you know, when you see your buddy win his six, you're happy because, you know, I mean, it's not like, oh, six came up, I didn't have that. No, you had something.
Yeah,
of that.
You had part
That's
of
what happens when people come up and we're at a big table and they want to play with us. And I say, okay, I'll take half your action.
Well, okay. Now, so that was the last thing I was actually going to say is you want to find somebody like Dr. Mike. You want to find a high roller who is making, you know, like a $60 bet on the six.
Yeah.
And you come up and you only want a $6 bet.
Yeah.
So you just give it to Mike and he puts that on top of his six. Bet. So now he's got a $66 six or eight.
Right.
And then, you know, he'll give you $7 when it hits.
Right. Now, the problem with that is you have to trust the other person.
Yeah, right. So
they
yeah.
know with me, when people do that with me, they know I'm in it. They're standing right there. I give them the money, you know, and we keep everything accurate. It can get confusing at times, too, because, you know, halfway through the big roll, now, did you have six? Or especially when they raise their bet, you know.
Oh, press that for me, Mike.
Yeah.
Okay.
you're trying to figure out, I've got 300 on there, and I think you have 12, so we have 312.
I think that's probably the least helpful advice, this last suggestion.
Well, it's the most confusing.
If you can find someone.
That could definitely happen. Let's say you're going with your father-in-law, and he happens to, you know, play.
He's like a big.
Well, he's, you know, or not big, but just, you know, he'll bet a $30 six and a $30 eight.
Right.
And you're like, I don't want to bet 30 because I've only got $200 for the whole day.
Yeah.
But, you know, adding $6 to his, so now he's got a $36 six.
Yeah.
That's a perfectly legitimate bet. And he's your father-in-law or whatever, you know. That's not a bad way to play.
Yeah. It's just a matter of finding the person.
Right. Well, you know, if you're in Vegas with a group, let's say you're with a group of friends, we've always gone. There's always one guy in the group who's betting more than other people.
Yeah.
So if you're in a group, that's probably a great way to go, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And you're having fun. You're all together at the same table.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Good. Well, thanks for this good advice, Dr. Mike.
Well, I hope it's somewhat helpful, but I mean, people shouldn't be afraid to go up and play at a higher limit. You just have to adjust.
You just have to adjust. Yeah.
You do that all the time.
Oh, that's what I'm doing now. Yeah. In order to play on the same table as you.
And it works out fine for you, right?
It's been going okay.
Okay is not the right word.
Well, I had a losing week this last week.
Very little.
I think I lost 20, 30 bucks, something like that. It was rough. Yeah. Hey, thanks to everyone who's been clicking through our Amazon link. Remember, whenever you're going to buy something through Amazon, please go to our page first, youcanbetonthat.com, and click through our Amazon link towards the top of the page. All right, let's move on to some voicemails. First up is our friend Melanie.
Hello, Mark. Hello, Dr. Mike. It's Melanie from Colorado, just back from a trip June 25th through the 27th to Vegas. And oh my goodness, Vegas is back. Went to see the new Resorts World. It's beautiful. Tables and tables for days. It's a beautiful property. It's immense. It's got high ceilings. You don't smell the smoke at all. A million restaurants. The pool deck had 6 of their 7 pools open and 3 hammocks, which are very comfortable. They did not check room keys to go out to the pool, so take advantage while you can. If you want to see their pool deck, it looks out onto the Las Vegas Strip if you look up, and a construction area if you look across. It's a south-facing pool, so it gets hot. It's on the south side of the hotel. Let's see, I walked through the Cosmopolitan at 7 a.m. on Saturday morning. The minimum was $100, and there was one person playing. I experienced something I hadn't seen before. So a woman sat down and proceeded to get out one of those flossers, you know, one of those special toothpicks that has a little area in the top that has a little piece of dental floss that you can brush your teeth. I'm like, oh my God, she's going to sit here and floss her teeth at the table, which I don't know. I've seen people walk around with a toothpick or whatever, but I was like, wow, this is a new one. So I played craps $5 at Ellis Island with a really fun crew. They also had that really fun front yard, and I wanted to go check out their tiki, and I wandered in there for a minute, but it was really loud and really crowded on a Sunday. Anyway, Sunday afternoon, I was playing airport craps, and airport craps is, of course, where you have your luggage in tow, but you stop at one more place and reach to the airport to play craps, which is exactly what I did. So I went to play with friends of the show, Gina, and as we walked by one of the craps tables, there was a stool, like a step stool. So I guess if someone is a little height challenge, which I am, you can step on the step stool and roll craps. I thought it was a riot. Had a full table there, but we were able to get on right away, had a wonderful time, and of course, you know, had my alarm on my phone set, and unfortunately when it was off, it was time to go. But the fun thing about airport craps is I still had most of my big girl left playing pass line with double odds and a lot of combats. It's just so fun playing airport craps because I feel like I can be, like, have a lot more action because I'm leaving and this is it. I have to get it in. Anyway, didn't have a winning session there, except it was winning in fun and friends, and that was great. Went to go see my friend's band, Dollface. They're playing every Saturday night, the Golden Nugget, for free. It's a really good show, and there are many venues for little live music bands all over the place that are happening, and it's really fun. People are super happy to be out dancing. Anyway, I think that's all I've got. But for some reason, Dr. Mike, that flosser story with you being a dentist, I guess you would approve. I was like, wow. For the record, she did not floss her teeth at the table. All right. Love the show, guys. Can't wait to hear it. Bye.
Yeah. What do you think about that?
I like it. Good oral hygiene at the table. I like picking up my chip, and then there's a chunk of something on there, and you're like looking at it. Oh, that's that's a piece of chicken from yesterday's lunch.
I can't tell you, folks, how many times we've gone to Vegas, and I will have forgotten dental floss.
Yes.
And I say, oh, Mike, I forgot the dental floss. Do you have some? No. What? You're a dentist.
Mark, we're on our way to Vegas. I'm thinking about one thing. I usually have to go buy some.
It's not teeth. You leave the teeth at home.
Yeah. The good hygiene stops. It's just like your good eating habits stop when you leave. Yes. Your good sleeping habits stop. I mean, what good habit do you take with you to Vegas? Honestly, you take all your bad ones.
Yeah, you do. I like to shave when I'm there.
Yeah, you do.
That's one thing that I don't like. See, having the scruffy.
I don't mind not shaving. I mean, wasted time shaving, that's Mark. I can't think of a bigger waste of time than shaving.
All right, we're going to hear from Melanie again a little bit later. All right, next call.
Hi, Mark and Dr. Mike. This is Ken from South Orange County, calling to ask you guys a question about something that happened at the craps table a long time ago, and just wondering how you guys would have handled the situation. I was at California Hotel Las Vegas, and the table was almost full, you know, and the shooter was doing okay. He was starting to get hot. He just hit his third point, and he's looking for the fourth point. So people have noticed that, and, you know, they want to join the table. So a couple guys throw their money down, and they want to jump into the game mid-row, I guess, like he's still shooting for a point. So not on the come out, which I didn't mind because these guys were players. You know, they gave their money and then they made their bets right away. So it was pretty quick. So it was okay for me. Anyway, so the shooter's got the dice. He's about to throw. And the boxman in the middle starts to hand a player's card to one of the players that just bought in. And both dice hit his hand. And the dice just dropped straight down right in the middle of the table. So they didn't even get past halfway point of the table. And the stick man called it seven up. And we were all shocked looking at that. Like, you know, shouldn't that be a no roll? But the dealers were so fast. You know, all the money was gone before someone said something to the box man. Like, hey, shouldn't that be a no roll? You know, like, what's going on? And the box man just said, hey, sorry, I was handing the player's card. And that was it. He didn't want to discuss it anymore. And after that happened, everybody left. That was a pretty bad customer service, I think. I think it should have been a no roll, but I was just wondering what you guys thought about that. Love the show. Glad you guys have been going strong for so many years and hope to play with you guys one day. Thanks.
Yeah, you know, we go back to that call that we got from Bear Mollings, right, who is pit boss and
right,
dealer.
Right, right.
Saying, you know, hey, a roll's a roll, and it wasn't intentional on the part of the boxman, and, you know, he is part of the table. But shoot, you know, the boxman, he's the one who is paying attention to the game, right? He's the one who's supposed to be really right. paying attention to the game and to be, you know, handing a card back when the dice are out.
Yeah, see, that's a mistake on his part.
Yeah.
Just hold on to the card till after the roll and the dice aren't out when they're in the middle. Just like you should not be making bets when the dice are already out to the shooter. He should not be handing anybody anything. However, I will say this in his defense.
Okay.
Let's say the dice hit him, and before they even get settled on the table, he yells out, no roll.
Okay, sure.
And if he yells out, no roll.
If that's his discretion, sure.
Yeah, at his discretion, he yells out, no roll, and it's a hard eight, and the point was eight. Everyone's going to be like, oh my God, it was a hard eight. We would have made our
right,
point.
It was,
we would have got paid on our hard ways, blah, blah, blah. You know, everyone's upset.
Yeah.
If he yells out, no roll, and it's a seven, oh, how nice,
yeah,
you know.
Right.
So he's in a no-win situation.
Oh, I agree, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I don't know. He probably did the right thing.
Maybe.
I mean, as far as the role goes,
as far as
like handing the card back, yeah, that's his bad.
Yeah, that was bad. Again, it's going to depend on how much discretion he has. I would like to think that if I had the discretion, I would have said no roll.
You're right.
You know, once
well,
it dropped.
Well, no, I would
but,
have.
But I agree. I'm giving the players a free roll in that case because if it had been the point, like you said. If
I was the box man and I, you know, wasn't even thinking, I didn't even realize the dice were already out and I handed the card, hit my hand. If it came up seven, I would have said no roll. And if it came up anything else, a point or whatever, I would have just said, okay, pay him.
Yeah.
You know, and then everyone's kind of happy because it was my fault.
Yeah.
Now, let's say he's not handing the card back. Let's say he's just standing there and the shooter rolls him willy-nilly. And his hands are, you know, on the rail.
Oh, sure, of course.
One of them hits his hands and goes on the table, and it's seven out. Well, you know.
Oh, that's no. Yeah, that's a no-brainer. That's a seven out. Yeah, that's a call.
He didn't do anything wrong, right?
That's a call. That's
just like, you see that all the time.
I would hope that if I had been the boxman, and I felt the dice hit my hand, I would hope that I would have gone and tried to grab them.
Yeah.
So that nobody could see and say no roll, right?
Right.
You know, grab no roll, right?
If you were Bruce Lee, that would have worked.
Now, that's not.
Now, if you're not Bruce Lee, it's probably pretty hard to have the dice hit you and then snag them before they hit the table.
I didn't.
Maybe the guy from Mr. Miyagi.
No,
Mr. Miyagi caught that fly.
Yeah, but didn't he use like chopsticks or something?
Right.
No, see, I'm not talking about catching the dice with chopsticks.
You would use your flosser. You're sitting there, you're the boxman, you're flossing your teeth.
Yeah,
the dice go down, you
catch
just scoop
with the flosser
up with
right
the flosser.
In their floss. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. All right, we're also going to hear from Ken again a little bit later on in the show. All right, next up is Niles.
Hey, how you guys doing? My name's Niles. I'm from Chicago, and I actually got two trip reports from you guys. First of all, I love the show. So back in May, I went to Vegas for my first time. So we stayed at the Flamingo, and not very happy with the Flamingo. The room we had, the hot water didn't work. Called the front desk, and all they would do was comp me $50. And I told them, I don't care about the $50. It was just, I wanted to get out and play. But at the same time, if you rent a hotel room, you should have hot water. So I'm kind of upset with the flamingo. And the reason I wanted to stay there was because, you know, Bugsy Siegel, you know, I'm into the mob, things like that. You know what I mean? So it was just the history of it, I guess. That's why we wanted to stay there. The only casino that had the lowest minimums on the craps table was Jerry's Nugget. And they had their $3 table. And there was a waiting line, though. You had to wait. So I had to wait about an hour to play. But that was on my third day. So on my first day, we walked down the strip, and all I play is craps. First, I played at the Flamingo, went about even. Then we went next door to the Cromwell and went down a couple hundred. And then walked into Planet Hollywood, and it was just vibing in there. It was such a good atmosphere. I went up 600, and it was a good trip. We went out to Red Rock. It was beautiful. So the Vegas trip, other than not having hot water at the Flamingo, the Vegas trip was good. But I do have another trip report. I'm from Chicago here, and me and my brother went out to the Harris in Joliet, Illinois. We were at the craps table, and we both bought in for 500, and I played conservative, and he played more aggressive. You know, I went up about 250, and he went up about 1,200. The dice come around the table, and this man starts arguing with one of the dealers. And I told my brother, I said, let's go. This is not a good feeling. I don't have a good feeling. And sure enough, guy hits a point, next roll, sevens out. My brother stayed for another two shooters, and I'm literally trying to drag him from the table. But however, before the dice went to the man that was arguing, they changed out the stick man, and it literally took them like 5 minutes to change out the stick man. And I heard that casinos will do this on purpose, that if there's a hot table, it'll go cold. So I just want to hear your guys' thoughts on that, and I really love your guys' show. It's awesome. I learn a lot from it, and thank you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Niles. Thanks. Yeah, you know, delaying the shooter, slowing down a game will not cool off a table. Again, there's no such thing as a hot or a cold table. But no, casinos don't employ things like that because they want a fast game.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, in essence, they want a fast game because the faster the game is, the more money they
make. Yeah, exactly.
They have an edge. However, and you know, I'm not completely superstitious, but there are plenty of times where it's stick change and then it's seven out. Slow stick change, seven out. Arguments, right? You know this. That's the best way to cool a table down. Someone argues, and then all of a sudden, and I know you don't believe in any of this stuff, and I'm not 100% I do either, because I never turn my bets off.
I know you don't. But
you never see me turn my bets off. And the other night, I was getting so mad because there was somebody who was turning their bets off, you know, every
time.
Well,
now you're like contradicting yourself, right?
Myself.
You're saying you're kind of superstitious, but you never turn your bets off.
No, because in my head, I know it really doesn't matter. But boy, it sure happens enough that you start to wonder, you know, is there something to that? You know what I mean?
I know what you mean, but
like,
I'm not
It's like, you know, I don't believe in haunted houses either, but then every once in a while, if something happens, you think, wow, you know, maybe there is something to that.
No. See, maybe you think that way. I absolutely do
I know
not.
You don't, because you're a machine. You're not real.
Anyway, Niles, getting back to your question. There are some
You don't need hot water, Mark, because you're not real. You can't even tell the temperature of the water.
There are casinos. There are casino personnel who are superstitious.
Right.
And, you know, there is a history of trying to pull stunts like this, but no, casinos aren't actively, oh, we got to cool this game off, you know, let's really make this stick change
I don't
slow.
Think there's somebody upstairs saying, oh, let's see what we can do to cool this table down.
But making a slow stick change is absolutely not something they would do, because like we said, the faster the game, the more money that they make.
Right. 50
well, we'll give you $50. No hot water, you're on vacation. You're in a hotel room.
I can see
we'll
it both. See that both ways. What do I need hot water for?
Oh, my gosh.
I need cold water to wake me up. I've been up all night. I got 30 minutes of sleep. I need cold water. That hot shower is not helping. Mm. Although, how can a place not have hot water?
Well, it must have been that room or a series of rooms, right?
Well, it'd be a series of rooms. I'm sure every
you would
room
think
doesn't
so.
Have its own hot water.
Either. Right. You would think so. It's probably
why wouldn't they say to you, oh, you know, the hot water heater is out, we're working on it the best we can. Can we comp
you?
Can we comp you a meal?
Maybe they didn't give him the whole story.
Yeah.
Sort of like, you know, we'll give you $50 right now. And maybe they didn't even tell them that somebody was working on it. Or who knows?
Yeah. I mean, but, you know, they should just say, someone's working on it. We'll get you hot water. How about a free meal? Can we buy you lunch?
Yeah.
You know, that would probably make most people happy.
Yeah.
You
know. With the promise that the hot water was coming.
Right. With a promise hot water is coming. Yeah, yeah. If they say, oh, sorry, you're not going to have hot water all week. And I'm going to give me another room.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Definitely.
Stupid flamingo.
Yeah. All right. Next call.
Hey, Mark and Dr. Mike, this is Dennis from Michigan. I have a short trip report from Gun Lake Casino in West Michigan. Fortunately, it's the first time at 100% everything I saw. No mask for the dealers, full craps tables, full blackjack tables, no partitions, no masks on the bartenders or the waitresses. The buffet is open. The sports book is wide open. Everything looked great. But the one thing that got my attention was pretty funny, and I'm not sure it's prevalent in all the casinos or not. But at Gun Lake, if you get a vaccine there, which they're offering to all people who aren't vaccinated, you'll get $40 worth of free play. So I thought that was great. $40 of free play for a vaccine. Thanks for the show and all you guys do. We love it. Take care.
Yeah, good. Thanks, Dennis. Yeah, Gun Lake Casino. So $40 in free play if you get both vaccines at their on-site clinic. You get $20 for your first shot, $20 for your second shot. If you only get your second shot there, they'll still give you $20 in free play. Now, make sure you call ahead if this is something you're interested in, because the clinic is only open certain days and hours. And it sounds like they had been giving $20 of free play to people who had been vaccinated, you know, no matter where they'd been vaccinated, just had to show their card.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, but apparently they're not doing that anymore. So again, it's the kind of thing where you'd have to kind of call ahead.
Too many people are vaccinated.
Well, it could be, right? Yeah, you know, that they were giving away too much free play in their minds. But yeah, so there you go.
So on Impractical Jokers, the TV show, they do this stunt where they come out of some meeting or something and there's a person who has to give them something, and they, the first time it's them, and then they dress in costumes or use weird accents to try and get, see how many times they can get through without this person recognizing them.
Uh-huh.
So here you go. You go to Gun Lake, you come out with, you know, different costumes every time, get $40. Mm-hmm. I mean, the same day, you just go out to your car, bring a bunch of different things, come in. You've got 80 vaccines in your arm. Your arms looks like, you know, it's Hulk Hogan's arm.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know how seriously people take you, Dr. Mike, because you are a doctor. I just want to make it clear that this is just all funny, goofy, don't do this.
Please don't.
Crazy.
Don't get more than the allotted 2 vaccines that you need.
All right, next call.
Hey, this is Landry from Orlando. I just listened to your July 2nd podcast, and it feels like you and Dr. Mike lost focus of what set your podcast apart from other podcasts, which is the focus on us recreational gamblers. The little quirks you and Dr. Mike made a fuss over is really what set us recreational gamblers apart from those uptight gamblers who tend to sour the gaming sessions for us recreational players. Your podcast sounded more indicative of one of those blackjack podcasts who can grumble about players not playing the way they want them to. Originally, I was looking forward to playing a crap session with you two, but the two guys on the latest podcast are usually the ones I avoid when playing. For now, if I happen upon you and Dr. Mike playing a crap session, you can bet I'll be close by, waiting for Dr. Mike to lose thousands making his prop bets. Then walk up to the table, look him in the eye, and ask, what happened? And hopefully he doesn't punch me in the face. Looking forward to hearing the next podcast with regards to playing at the $25 table with a small budget. Remember, keep the focus on us recreational gamblers, where a huge focus is on the fun. So hopefully that was an off session for you guys, but I do enjoy the podcast and really looking forward to the next one. Take care.
You know, this previous podcast might have been kind of polarizing for listeners. Let me read an email we got from listener Jim. He said, I have listened to your entire catalog and haven't heard a bad episode yet. Having said that, your most recent episode was magnificent. Not sure what it takes to get Dr. Mike fired up, but if you could work on that before each recording, that would be super. Keep up the great work. So here's an example where Jim just thought it was, you know, hilarious, whereas Landry really felt, you know, the opposite. Now, there's no...
Well, maybe I was too goofy. I don't know.
I don't think you were too goofy. You were definitely fired up last week.
Oh, I was fired up,
And here's the thing, is that we're pretty positive guys, right? We and one
for
of the
most
things,
part we are.
Yeah, one of the things that we really try to do on this show is to keep it positive. But I mean, you know, we're human, and there are going to be days where, you know, we've had a bad day and we're just angry, and you know, we're kind of
things aren't going too well, and you get a little fired up. I mean, I don't know. I how often I get like that. Yeah. Most of the time, I'm pretty, I think, nice.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. Well, here's the thing, and I certainly understand Landry's point. I definitely do. You know, but we weren't really trying to make fun of the recreational gamblers. In fact, it's kind of funny. We were kind of making funny of the people who take it really seriously,
right?
But that we think are misguided, like the person who, you know, spends an inordinate amount of time, you know, setting the dice and rubbing their hands on the table, and then is so angry.
Yeah.
You know, when it doesn't work out, you know, things like that. So, you know, we're going to keep trying to keep it light. And but we're going to be, you know, so kind of sarcastic and poking fun at people, you know, as the time goes on.
Yeah, I definitely don't mean to offend anybody.
Yeah. If you ever were to come up to us, you'll find that we're not sitting there just grumbling and, you know, complaining about everybody at the casino.
No, that is far from the truth.
Yeah.
There are times when we're losing where we're not really happy.
No, of course, sure.
Me more than you. I get upset.
You're more moody. Yeah, you definitely are.
I get upset because it's like, gosh, how can it be this bad?
Yeah.
I'm not mad at anyone in particular.
Right.
Or any dealer or player or anything. I'm just mad at the stupidity of the waves, you know.
How can the dice be this bad so long?
So long. I mean, you know, we're beating the odds when, you know, we've had seven outs in a row.
Yeah.
I mean, that statistically should not happen very often, but it seems to.
Yeah, well, of course.
Anyway.
Yeah, we want this to be a positive show. And, you know, most of the time we're looking across each other and smiling and, you know, trying to have a good time. So we're going to continue to try to be that way. Keeping in mind that, again, every once, you know, you come straight from work when we record this, right?
I come straight from work every time.
You know, and you've got a stressful job, and you're dealing with the public every day. And so sometimes that's going to come out in the show. But I think, again, for the most part, I think we're pretty fun-loving guys if you met us. All right, let's hear from Melanie again.
Hey, Mark. Hey, Dr. Mike. Just wanted to also give you an update on Colorado sports betting online, which is great. We're getting more and more operators online, and they're getting easier to make deposits with. So one of them is called WinBet. They have the $5 free bet, risk-free bet, which is a common promotion here in Colorado. And for those that don't know, that means that if you bet up to $500 and you lose it, you get a $500 free bet. So what I've been doing is signing up for two at a time, and I'll get a $500 risk-free bet on one and the other, hedge against each other. If you do that, make sure that you try and get on the hook. So, like, if they're supposed to win by two, maybe don't bet that, but if 2.5, bet that, because if you push your win bet, you will not get to do your risk-free bet again. Anyway, one of the prizes they have is you can spin this wheel when you do a parlay. And on the wheel, once a day, until somebody wins it, there's a free room at the win, and that includes resort fees. So when you bet a parlay, I would bet like a dollar on a two-team parlay and get to spin the wheel. And doing that, I won two night stays at the Wynn for free. And when I went to book, sure enough, they booked weekends. So that was incredible. I couldn't believe it. Anyway, highly recommend it if anyone is in Colorado. You don't have to live here. You just have to be here to place bets. Anyway, love the show, guys. Bye.
All right. Thanks, Melanie. I want to emphasize, too, she's talking about these risk-free bets, which we definitely encourage people to do if they're able to. If you're going to play two bets against each other, make sure you're not creating two accounts with the same sports book. You want to be doing two different companies, two accounts, two different companies. You know, so those are battling it out. There's nothing wrong with that. But if a company finds out you've got two accounts and, you know, you're playing that, then you might get in some trouble. So just keep that in mind.
Right. What Melanie failed to tell us is that the free rooms, one night there's no water at all.
Uh-huh.
And the other night it's sometimes super scalding hot, sometimes ice cold. It's just, it's a gamble. It's a wheel you spin. What are you going to get tonight?
Okay. So at least on that first night, you're not going to get hurt because you're not going to even try to get in the shower.
You're not
getting
any water at all. Yeah.
All right. Next call.
Hello, Mark and Dr. Mike. This is Stephen calling from Fresno, California. Wanted to give a quick trip report from Chichanti Gold Resort and Casino in Corscord, California. Two stories I want to go over today. Me and my wife went up 4th of July weekend, and while we were having dinner at the cafe there, I was telling my wife and joking with her telling her that she's going to win nothing on a 40-cent bet. She's an ultimate low roller. She loves betting 40 cents. I was telling her, you can't win anything playing 40-cent bets. Well, we go out to play. I get a call later from her. You know what she had won? She had won the Maxi. $4,000 on 4th of July. Another story, I was playing three-card poker, and the dealer was fairly new, and I was getting paid on the play bet when the dealer didn't qualify. Well, the person next to me kept correcting the dealer, saying, oh, no, you can't pay that play bet because your hand didn't qualify. What an annoying thing to happen. Mind your business, as I say, right? All right. Nice talking to you guys. Keep up the good work. Bye-bye.
Yeah, so thanks. In three-card poker, yeah, you make an ante bet, and then if you decide you want to play, you make this additional play bet.
Right.
And if the dealer doesn't qualify, dealer has to have queen high or higher to qualify. So if the dealer has less than that, the play bet is actually a push. They just give it back to you, and you only win the ante.
Right.
It's only when they qualify that you actually compare hands and then win or lose both the ante and the play. So that's what he's talking about there. Yeah, you know, it's not quite as bad when it's actually somebody at the table who's playing who maybe says something.
Right.
At least it wasn't somebody walking by and, oh, you made a mistake there.
Yeah.
Shouldn't have paid the play. But yeah, you know, that's one of those.
Maybe that'll be my retirement job, just going around the casino looking for errors and correcting them. That's my job.
Yeah, and you don't tell the casino that's what you're doing. You just go to HR afterwards. Well, I saved you about $500 today. What are you going to give me? Sir, do we know you?
Maybe I do it for free. I don't want to get paid. It's just my civic duty.
That's right.
to correct all the errors.
It's your moral dilemma. All the times you were overpaid.
Right.
As a youth at the casino, you're now making up for it. But
I'll come back as some kind of angel who goes around, you know.
An angel.
They'll make a TV show out of it. Michael Landon will play me.
The Casino Angel. Well, that sounds like a good show. No, he works for the casino.
He works for the casino. He's really a douche.
All right, let's hear from Ken again.
Hi, Mark and Dr. Mike. This is Ken from South Orange County. I'm just calling to do a trip report to Harrah's Rincon in San Diego. The 25 minimum craps table was open. There's no one on it, so I like to shoot, so I decided to try my luck at it. And I was doing okay, but then suddenly I had a good row. I made 3 points, and my next point was a six. By that point, I decided to start playing hard ways. So I had $5 for me and $1 for the dealers. And I'm rolling and rolling, and I hit the hard six. So, like Dr. Mike always says, parlay. So I parlayed it. 50 for me and 10 for the dealers. And I noticed that a hard six was natural, meaning the dice of 3-3 was the same as 3 on the cards. So I knew exactly what I needed to get it. So I roll on the come out, and my next point is a 9. So I'm rolling and rolling, and boom, hard 6. And I yell right away. As soon as the dice comes out, 3-3, I'm cheering and yelling hard 6. And everyone else on the table is waiting for the stick man to call it. And the stick man looks down at the cards, calls hard 6, and he looks at me and says, how'd you know? And I told him, because I parlayed it. That's one for you, Dr. Mike. And just to make you happy, Mark, I did not parlay it again.
Good.
I just pressed it to 100. The dealers went to 25, and I collected the rest. Now, that was a good thing because my next roll was a 7 on the cards. So that ended my good roll, but I made 4 points, and I hit a parlay hard 6. So I enjoyed it. I also wanted to comment, before I listened to your show, I would always tip the dealers when I leave the table. And I was thinking about what Dr. Mike said, you know, just tip a dollar. So I was doing that. Whatever number of place bets I had, I would put a dollar out for the dealers. If I bet a hard way, I put a dollar out for the dealers. And I like how it changed the atmosphere of the table. You know, the dealers are more into it because they have something to look forward to. I talked to them about, okay, well, what do you want to do now? You guys want to press your bet? You guys want to collect? You know, they're more talkative, and I feel like it's just more fun on the table.
And also, when I do it, other players were doing it too, so I think it helps them out. But I just want to say thank you for the show and hope to see you guys at Harrah's soon. All right. Bye-bye.
Yeah, good story, Ken. And yeah, that's the reason that we like tipping during play as opposed to waiting till the end.
Right.
Because, yeah, they're in the game. They're having fun with it.
And the dealers at Harrah's, Southern California, I think, are some of the friendliest dealers.
Yes.
Not all of them are super proficient because there are some new guys learning some new ones and stuff.
Yeah.
But they are always very friendly and nice. So that goes a long way in my book.
Yeah. And Ken makes a good point, too. It gets other people to tip when maybe they weren't even thinking about it, right? Because, again, especially with new craps players, they may not even realize they can tip by making bets for the dealer.
Yeah, well, any new gambler always, that's one of the things. How do I tip? Because, nobody, there's nothing ever said about that, right?
Yeah, right. You know? Yeah, well, the dealers aren't supposed to say anything, right?
You know? Right, yeah. They're not.
They can't hustle for tips,
For tips. Yeah. But, it is something you have to learn or see someone else do and wonder. I've had people ask me, what's that bet there? Oh, that's for the dealers.
Right, right.
Or, why is that guy putting an extra dollar besides his blackjack bet?
Yeah, right.
Well,
it's
just for the dealers. Yeah. So until you know that, how would you know?
Yeah, you don't know what you don't know.
Right.
All right, next call.
Hey, Mark and Dr. Mike. This is Tony from Utah. I was calling in to ask you a question about rewards cards. So a few weeks ago, on the My Vegas Slots app, they recently added Montego Bay in Wendover. So I got two free nights. My wife and I, we decided to head out there. We were only going to stay one night, but it was nice not having to worry about when to check out. Super nice. As soon as we got there, customer service in Wendover is really, really good. I think our entire check-in time was like 2.5 minutes. They didn't even take like a credit card with my ID. I guess it's because it was just totally comped. I figured they would need one for the security deposit. Anyway, so I hadn't signed up for a rewards card out there yet. So the first thing I did, since we checked in, went down there, got a rewards card. But the interesting thing is out in Wendover, to reach the second tier status, you only need 100 points. And it's so easy to hit that. I think I hit it in like 3 or 4 hours, and we were there on like a 2x tier point multiplier weekend. So we got it pretty quickly. I was pretty happy. We got like some credit to use in the gift shop and stuff. Well, anyway, so I went to the desk and asked if I could get my card upgraded. And they said that I wasn't allowed to get the new one printed because I hit the 100 points that day. And I guess that kind of threw me off because a few weeks ago when I was in Vegas, I hit Pearl status with MGM and they printed me out a new card as soon as I hit that. I gave them a receipt from the dinner and it put me over points and they just printed out my new card. So I just wanted to ask if that's a normal thing, if you've seen that before, or if this is the first time you've ever heard of it. Thankfully, I'm going out there again in a few more days and I'm going to get the new one printed out. So it's not that big of a deal. But otherwise, super fun trip. Wendover already sent me an offer for 2 free nights and then $10 in free play. Great customer service. Also, just one more small thing. I went to Mesquite, stayed at the Casablanca Mesquite a few weeks ago, and today I got a mailer with $10 in free play, some food vouchers, and then I get 4 free nights between Sunday and Thursday, which is crazy. I think I spent like $75, but anyway, great time. Thanks, guys. Thank you for the podcast. Hope you have a great day. Bye.
All right. Thanks, Tony. Yeah. We've never heard of them not printing up a new card when you got because it was the same day. I wonder if they're just concerned about the cost of printing new players' cards because it sounds like Tony actually did make the tier level. It wasn't like they were denying him that.
Yeah.
They just wouldn't print out a new card.
Well, maybe they're trying to conserve plastic.
Maybe, but
I
he's going to get
be, It well, could yeah. be an environmental thing, right? Like, maybe this guy doesn't come here again. Maybe he's just visiting once and we waste 2 cards.
I will say this. When I went to the Gardens Casino up in the LA area, it's like a card room, players' cards were free for new members. And I was a new member. But if you wanted a replacement card, you had to pay for it.
Really?
That was to really discourage people from losing their cards.
Well, then what happens when you lose a bunch of money and you throw your card in the trash on the way out, and then you're there the next day and you need a card?
Yeah, I don't know. I should have asked about that. Is that something that happens a lot?
That happens a lot, Mark.
Okay.
I'm never coming back, and that card goes right in the trash.
And I snicker because I've seen it a million times before. You know, that is weird that they didn't ask for a credit card when he checked it. I wonder if maybe they had his information somehow and he didn't know, because
they just messed up. Well, maybe the person checking in just messed up, because it's not for expenses. It's for, you know, any damages or anything that might happen.
Whatever their rationale is.
Right.
They say it's for incidentals. Like if you charge something to the room, right? You get a movie or eat and charge it to there. You use the mini bar, something like that.
I think it's more for if there's damages incurred that they have a way to...
they have something some means there.
I'll tell you what. When we get a casino, Mark, he mentioned that, you know, they got a few points that he could use at the gift shop and buy something, right? We are going to have everyone who gets a new card is automatically going to be able to go to the gift shop and get a Hershey's bar with almonds.
Okay.
Just that's complimentary.
Complimentary.
Just for getting a new card.
All right. Let me ask you this. I'm allergic to almonds. What's my option?
Well, you have no option because Hershey's with almonds is my favorite candy bar.
Uh-huh.
So that's what you're getting.
Yeah.
Now,
it's a picture of you on the wall holding one up, you know.
And now
complimentary thanks to Dr. Mike.
Now, you can take that and give it to your friend if you're allergic. I mean, or your wife or spouse or whoever. Uh-huh. I mean, you know, you don't have to eat it.
Yeah.
But it is the highly suggested candy bar of choice.
Okay. I can just see the TV ad now. All right. Next call.
Hi, Dr. Mike. Just wanted to do a quick shout out for y'all and thank you for your podcast. They have helped me get through COVID. This is Steve from Virginia. Last time I called you was on my trip to the World Series of Poker 2019. So it's been a while. I just wanted to give you another update. I had the opportunity to go down to Cherokee Casino in North Carolina, and it was a blast. I will say that the tables for craps, $15 minimum. I did manage to get onto the shoot for win.
Probably roll to win.
Which was fun.
Yeah.
And I ended up having two back-to-back fairly decent rolls. I started out with $100, and I managed to walk out with $1,600 just off of my shooting. It was a fun time. Food, as per usual, was good. Hotel rates, even for Cherokee, are a little expensive. Harrah's, for some reason, now I'm not a high roller by any means, but for some reason, my offers just have been garbage. I was hoping on your next episode you could talk a little bit about if we are going to see any increases from Harrah's or if the El Dorado merger has really soured the give back. And when you come to play in North Carolina, please let us know beforehand because I would love to come meet you guys. Thank you, and you have a good day now.
Oh, yeah, we definitely will. That's on the top of the way. Yeah,
yeah, that's one of my places I really, really want to go to. Yeah, yeah. So,
now, we don't have any kind of inside information about how the El Dorado acquisition of Caesars is affecting players or will ultimately affect players. But we will say this. The grumblings in the community are that Caesars Rewards are not what they used to be. People are not getting the value from it that they used to.
And I'm getting a lot less in offers than I used to.
I imagine this trend is going to continue and maybe even get worse. But again, that's just speculation on my part. But you are not alone, Steve. A lot of people are seeing their offers have gone down quite a bit. So
yeah, I think it's going to go that way. Now, will that hurt them enough that eventually it goes back up because they figure, you know, well, we got to do something?
Yeah.
Or will people just be happy with it?
We'll see. I hear a lot of people defecting, for lack of a better word, to MGM, right? You know, so maybe if Caesars feels that, maybe, but, you know, we'll see.
Yeah. Yeah. It's hard to tell. Steve mentioned watching the World Series, or he went to the World Series of Poker in 2019.
Yeah.
And just as a side note, I was watching poker on TV the other night, late at night, and I just couldn't sleep. And so I'm going through the channels, and I started watching some poker. And I love watching that, actually, because I like to analyze what they should have done or what happened.
You're thinking, I would have done this.
Which is easy to do when, you know, you can see the other people's cards and stuff.
Yeah.
But anyway, one thing I noticed, so this was during pandemic times.
They were playing during the so they were all wearing masks and everything.
Yeah,
okay,
they were all wearing masks.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, it was a few months old.
Okay, it wasn't the World Series of Poker.
No, it wasn't the World Series of Poker.
It happened during the shutdown.
Yeah, it was one of those Poker Stars tournaments or something. And they were all wearing masks. And you know what? It really took a lot away from me as a viewer.
Really? Because you couldn't see any kind of expression?
Because I could still see the cards, but I couldn't see their expression. Yeah. Half the fun for me is like one guy giving that look like, what the hell's this guy doing? Right. You know, or when one guy would say some stupid comment, because there were a couple of guys who were talkers.
Yeah, right. Trying to get a rise out of other people.
Uh-huh. And I love seeing, but with that mask on, you couldn't really tell. Yeah. And one guy would just sit there and they would, you know, throw some weird comment towards his way. And he would just sit there.
Yeah,
and I couldn't see if it bugged him or not. Yeah. And, you know, as a fan, I love to see that. I like that. So, yeah, that's one thing I definitely not miss about the pandemic is people wearing a mask. I mean, there may be people who wear their masks from now on just so they don't show anything, right?
No facial expression. It's good for gamblers in a lot of ways, right? APs, poker players, a lot of people.
Two little holes cut out for your pupils, right?
All right, one last call. On our last episode, we were talking about how in Biloxi, at least, there have been some craps tables that have minimum buy-in requirements. And we hadn't seen that before, and we were kind of speculating on why that was and how long it would be. Well, we got kind of a funny story from Vin right here.
Hi, this is Vin from Pennsylvania, and this is in regards to the $100 buy-in minimums. There's a don't player at my local casino that buys in for a few dollars after every roll because he believes it will bring the seven. So this not only annoys the players, but the dealers too. Time is money for the casino, so I'm sure they're not happy with that either. Anyway, I can't understand having that as a minimum at certain places. So that's just my take on it. Thank you for a great show.
Okay, thanks. So who knows if this was happening in Biloxi, but could you see this don't player?
Yeah.
Just every roll, okay, I'll buy in for another $7. All right, oh another $12.
I am very, very surprised the casino wouldn't put a stop to that real quick.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, because that, they don't want a slow game, like we said before, and players don't want a slow game. That's just ridiculous.
Yeah, it's making everybody mad. Yeah. There's probably not a rule, you know, against it, but, you know, make a rule. Yeah, that would be
pretty
annoying.
You might have to make a rule. If I if that guy was a regular there, I'd make a rule. No, you know, minimum buy-in, whatever, you know, $100, just so he can't buy in for a couple of bucks. So his idea is that he's slowing the game down, seven will come out.
Well, I think what he's thinking, he's using the superstition that when somebody buys in the middle of a roll, a seven comes out, right? Yeah. So either way, it works for him,
I guess. He's pulling out 50-cent pieces. I just need 50 cents more. You got some of those 50-cent chips here at this table?
That's right. If not, I'll just
Here's
give
two
you-
of them. Every roll.
I think maybe I'd like to see this guy in action now that you're going through.
And he could punch me. I'd let him punch me. I mean, honestly, nothing would stop me from saying, come on.
Oh my gosh. All right. Well, that's going to do it for this episode. We want to thank some people for some recurring PayPal donations. Kurt, Justin, Robin from Anytime Gambling, and Nathan. Thank you very much. We also got a donation from William. I think he goes by Billy. Heading to Vegas tomorrow, looking for some hot rolls on the craps table. Love the podcast. Thank you for what you guys do. Well, hopefully you had a good trip.
Yeah, hopefully he's still there now.
Yeah, really. Also, a donation from Troy and Jennifer. Karma donation for our first trip since May of 2019. Cosmo, Cal, and Downtown Grand for a 7-day bar top video poker-a-thon. Ooh, 7 days. Good luck.
Right.
Also, a donation from Lori. I was kind of grumpy on my commute before episode 236. Your commentary on what went wrong, how'd that happen, cracked me up so much. I think people will think I'm crazy when I visit Vegas next month. I'm a woman, so maybe they won't punch. So I guess Lori liked the last episode.
Lori liked that. What went wrong?
That's right. And also a donation from Randy. Karma donation for our first trip in over 2 years. August 2nd through the 6th at the D. Love the show. Well, thank you very much, Randy, and for everybody's donation.
Yes.
Hey, be sure to check out our TV listings showing all the gambling-related shows coming up within the next 2 weeks at youcanbetonthat.com/TV-listings and our list of gambling-related movies at youcanbetonthat.com/movies. We'd love to hear from you. Call our voicemail hotline at 951-292-4377. That's 951-2-WAGERS.
951-2-WAGERS.
Or you can email us at youcanbetonthat@gmail.com. You can also follow us on Twitter at youcanbetonthat and on Facebook at facebook.com/youcanbetonthat. Finally, please go to your favorite podcast app and write a review of the show. We love getting your feedback. Dr. Mike.
Well, you failed to mention on this show, and if you don't know this, then it's going to be the first time I've scooped you on anything.
All right.
New restaurant coming to Harrah's Rincon, Southern California.
And is it a Gordon Ramsay restaurant, yes. Dr. Mike?
Another Hell's Kitchen. You didn't mention that. I thought you might leave.
You're right. I did not. I completely forgot to mention on the show. But yeah, I found out about that too. We got a Hell's Kitchen coming
Hell's
our way.
Hell's Kitchen coming, I think they said in 2022.
Okay.
But they're going to start working on it this summer.
Well, good. Because the food at Harrah's Southern California, it's never been really anything to talk about. So.
No, it's not. Some of the places aren't bad. They're just nothing to rave about.
It's fine. It's just, there's... Yeah.
So I'm hoping that this turns into quite a thing. And they said they were going to have a lounge, and it's like the biggest Gordon Ramsay seated restaurant, 232 capacity.
Oh, okay, great.
So that's... I'm thinking it's going to be where the old buffet is.
Yeah, you're right, because that is a big space.
It's a huge space.
You can tell they have no intention of...
Yeah, if the buffet's never coming back, then that's going to be a big Gordon Ramsay restaurant, which would be great.
Yeah.
And maybe we'll see some fireworks in there.
Yeah, maybe.
And the other thing I want to mention is you can't do this because this would be a shameful plug on your part, but I can do it because I can say pretty much anything I want. I want to mention that Mark and Tim Lawson at The Better Life do a show about movies where they review gambling movies.
Yep.
And if you haven't heard that, you should take a listen to that because it is entertaining. And there are movies on there I didn't even know existed that now I want to watch.
Yeah, we're having a lot of fun with that. I join him once a month on his show. And this next episode, which should be coming up in about 3 weeks or so, we're going to be reviewing Mississippi Grind, a relatively new movie. Have you seen that? Okay.
Yeah.
And Two for the Money with Matthew McConaughey and Al Pacino about sports betting. Have you seen that one?
No, I have not. The last one you reviewed, what was it?
So we did California Split and Lay the Favorite were the last two.
Yeah, Lay the Favorite. I see. I hadn't seen that. Yeah, so now I'm curious to watch the movie.
Yeah.
So good job.
Thank you.
You guys are good. And I just wanted to mention that because I know you wouldn't do that. You're much too modest of a person.
I am very modest. You got that right. All right. Thanks for listening.
Good night.
El Cajon? That's the anus of San Diego.